Hey, what's up? I'm making an Owl House video now because the new episode, Them's the Breaks Kid, has just released. So, quick little aside before we talk about today's episode. I'm very new to just reviewing cartoons. It's just something that I've wanted to do for a long time, but haven't really, you know, had the opportunity to. Recently, I just started reviewing Amphibia, talking about the villain of Amphibia. I won't go into too many details yet if you haven't seen that, but I'm going to talk about a lot more cartoons on this channel, mainly the Owl House and Amphibia. Recently, and I'll branch out to other cartoons, but as these cartoons are airing, I'm probably gonna be talking about these ones a lot. So today, I'm gonna be talking about this episode, and it was pretty good. I'm actually a big fan. So Ida is actually probably my favorite character from the Owl House. I've rewatched the entire Owl House twice, and I'm pretty sure that Ida is my favorite. She's so funny. She's just absolutely just chaotic evil. She's such a funny character. I absolutely love Ida. She's a great time. I'm also big fans of Hunter and Amity, but they're like close seconds. I think Hunter and Amity are like close seconds, but Ida does come at number one. And honestly, Rain is becoming a very interesting character too. It felt like Rain was a very late addition to the show, as we know that Owl House was canceled and isn't gonna have a lot more, you know, a lot more time to flesh out its story. It only has, I believe, the rest of season two and then three specials as a season three, which are like going to be 40 minutes long or something. So basically like six more episodes or something. I forget exactly how long, but there's not a ton of time for them to finish this series, which is sad because I think that they're struggling to make their vision come reality. Obviously they're going to, you know, work with what they've got, but that's my knowledge of the show situation right now. And it makes me question if, like, they wanted more time to flesh out Rain, which I see them doing a lot recently, because Rain was very late, a late addition, appeared in season two. Obviously, you know, other characters in other shows, for example, like Marcy and Amphibia appeared in season two, but it's not gonna have another whole season, so I don't know. I'm a big fan of Rain so far, and I like how this episode kind of fleshes them out as a character, especially with their relationship to Ida. So we've seen quite a bit into Ida's past already, having the freaking orange hair. I like how, like, Ida and Lilith have completely different hair colors from how they are now. Obviously, I think it's due to the curse that Ida's hair color has changed, to my knowledge. And I believe Lilith dyed her hair? I think that's what it's confirmed to be. Apparently, like, hers is also kind of gray, because doesn't she have, like, a gray streak in her hair? I'm not entirely sure. But I like how we get to see the dynamic of, you know, how they were when they were younger, how we see, you know, Lilith's blossoming jealousy about how Ida sort of at least appears on the surface to just get everything first try. It starts off, like, Ida starts off her backstory going through note cards and being like, oh, let's study together. And Lilith, as we can see, is sort of struggling, or at least compared to Ida is struggling. We see her be like, oh, is it a waning moon or a waxing moon? It definitely depends. And she's like, no, it doesn't. It's like, yes, it does. And then Lilith checks, and obviously Ida's right. And it feels so weird because Lilith, obviously, just feels, if you, like, look at these two, you obviously see, oh, Ida's a jock. You know, she looks like a jock. She's got the frickin' sports vest on, which Luce was wearing in the last episode, which I think is pretty cool. She's got the frickin' Grudgeby ball. You know, if you just look at this picture, you can obviously tell one on the left is a jock, the one on the right is, like, a nerd, or at least, you know, that's how it appears to be. But Ida obviously does her fair share of studying, and she's bright enough to know, you know, a lot about magic, and then obviously makes Lilith seem inferior. So I really like how they portray this in this episode. One little small thing I like in this episode is we potentially see some ancestors of our favorite characters, but we see quite a few characters. So right here, it looks like we have Bosha's ancestor to the right with the freaking hair. We see the three eyes. This is surely Bosha's ancestor, probably her mother. On the left, I thought, like, Willow, maybe at first. I'm not entirely sure. I feel like it could be Willow. But Willow has two dads, but obviously she had to have a mom to be born, so maybe something happened there. And then to the left of them, we see what looks to be Gus. Now, Gus is interesting because he had, like, that weird growth spurt, and this kind of just, like, looks pretty much entirely like Gus. Like, it looks almost exactly like him, dude. We've seen his father, like, a couple times. I think we saw him at the end of season one when Ida was going to be petrified, because he's, like, a news anchor or whatever. But then over here, we have what I think is a really cool dynamic. We see, you know, the Blight mother and father. I forget exactly their names, but we see Darius as well. So Darius is, like, a kind of a new character. Darius was, like, a big threat earlier, where we saw his first appearance when he was, you know, going up against Ida and Rain with that weird cat creature, which reminds me of that one weird cat creature from that Scooby-Doo movie. Anyway, we see them getting along, which I think is kind of cool. So we see, like, interactions of characters that are grown up now. Like, Darius is pretty cool. We've even seen him kind of be, like, a pseudo-father toward Hunter, which I absolutely love. I absolutely love that. That was such a good episode. But we kind of see already how Amity's parents are sort of getting along. And even with, like, still high society people, like Darius. Darius obviously becomes a coven head. We don't know what his status is now, but he becomes a coven head in the future. So I just like how we get to see them messing around with, like, abomination magic, because they're all abomination magic users, and I think that's so cool. What was Amity's mom in? I think she was in, like, telepathy. I don't know. I forget, though, the name of the thing, name of the coven, but, like, you know, she's in her own thing. But I like how, like, the abomination users, because they're in class together, and it's very cool how, like, you get to see them grown up. I don't know. I like how we get to see just a lot of the ancestors. It's just, like, a very short clip, but I like how we get to see them all here. That was, like, I love it when they do episodes in the past. It's so funny because both Amphibia and Owl House had, you know, flashback. These are both flashback episodes for both of the series, which I think was very cool. They both had them released on the same weekend. It's hilarious. I also love Young Bump. Dude, Young Principal Bump is a riot, dude. He's so funny. He's just, like, he's just an insecure, not confident Principal Bump. It's so funny, dude. It's hilarious. And, like, the other principal, what's his freaking name? Faust. Principal Faust. Okay, that's his name. He's a freak, dude. He's so funny. I love this guy. He's, like, actually intimidating. He's creepy. He's got those weird devil horns. It's something that you'd expect a teacher on the Boiling Isles to be. I like this guy. I don't know if we've ever seen him reappear, but he's very funny. I'm a big fan of him. I like how we also see the eyeball guy later, too. I don't know if it's the same guy. It could be, like, his ancestor. But we also see that freaking eyeball guy who, like, reappears, who likes eating his own eyeballs. He appears later, which I think is pretty cool. Moving on a bit through the episode, I like how we get the introduction of Tara Snapdragon. She's been getting a lot of screen time lately, and she feels like a very big threat. Like a big, big threat. She is very much set in her own ways. She's very intelligent, as we've seen. And she has quite an interesting relationship to Ida and Rain. Her like ties with Rain are very interesting, as we see at the end of the episode. But yeah, we see, you know, Tara's doing her own thing. She wants to poison students and do illegal activities. But whatever, we go through the episode, Ida goes through some trials that are dumb, and she meets Rain, and they hit it off pretty quickly, how, you know, Rain shows her the bard magic, which is pretty cool. And together they do some, you know, funny shenanigans, and we can already, like, see their blossoming friendship, or even their romance, you know, kind of together, how Ida sees Rain as, it's, like, weird, because they're both very smart, but they both enjoy doing their own thing at the same time, which I think is also why Tara sort of took a liking to them, where it's like they're similar, you know, they're similar. Tara is extremely intelligent, but she likes doing her own thing, even if it's like freaking illegal. She breaks the rules because she wants to, and that's similar with these two. It's just under Bellos, they're kind of just under this sort of, or even just anyone. As we see, there's a lot of like stuff in this episode where it's like pressure from outside forces against the youth. Or a lot of these, like, children in this program don't even want to be here. They think it's boring, but they have expectations put onto them, what, by their parents, by their teachers, by other people. And I think that's really interesting, because maybe even Tara has those herself. I don't know. I feel like she might have more depth. Right now, she just feels like a villain. We don't really see too many other sides of her. But I think it's just kind of cool. You know, it's a thing to note, which is maybe why she, you know, at the very end, sort of was like, hey, you guys aren't bad. That's pretty cool. She, like, stuck her neck out for them, which I think is neat. I don't know. I just like how we get to see Rain and Ida work together, and they're just similar. Like, they have their own way of winning the trials, and it's just, it's cool. It's cool. And then even Rain, you know, moves to Hexside at the end of the episode just because of how they felt. Even, I love how the last trial goes, when Tara's like, all right, this is boring. Let's just do it, like, make it a battle royale. Just, like, go out, play Fortnite, guys, have a battle royale. And I love how it ends, how it's just, you know, Ida refuses to battle her new friend, Rain. And, like, I like how when they're about to duel, I was like, surely they're just going to attack Tara. I, like, literally predicted the end of this episode how it's happening. I was like, surely they're going to come together and they're just going to attack Tara. But no, they did their funny little dance and then they attacked Tara, which I was like, okay, you caught me off guard with the dance. But I predicted the freaking attack onto Tara, which I thought was pretty cool. And even Principal Bump's getting his moment by, like, you know, going up against Tara as well. I don't know. I think it's a really good freaking scene. And she thought it was funny, you know, Tara's a very interesting, you know, freaking villain. I like how we're seeing a lot more of the coven heads recently. Obviously, we don't see too much detail of all of them, but we see a lot of Rain, we see a lot of Darius, we see a lot of Tara. I don't know. It's good. We see a lot of those threes, especially. And there's freaking 9 of them, so it's going to be kind of hard to flesh them all out as characters. But it seems like they're going to be focusing on, you know, specifically Terra, Rain, and Darius, which I think is pretty cool. But, you know, I love how this episode at the very start kind of talks about how, you know, they show the relationship between Ida and Lilith, how they're sort of drifting apart, which obviously does come, you know, into play because they start to drift apart. Lilith curses Ida with the freaking owl beast. And they just, you know, they go their separate ways. Lilith joins the coven, and then Ida stays a wild witch, selling garbage, which is literally what someone joked about, how it's like, oh, you're just going to be selling garbage or something, which is what she does, which I think is so funny.
But also, I think we're toast. My career is over, and you'll be expelled and probably end up selling garbage at the night market.
This episode really shows how Ida found a friend in Rain, and they continued to be friends, or even, like, you know, more. I just like how she talks to Rain about how her sister Lilith is, like, her only friend, and then Rain's like, well, we're friends now, you know, we can be pals, and she's like, oh, okay, yeah, sure, I'll take that. I don't know, I just really like the ending of this episode, where you see Lilith, you know, she's doing her best to study and try and catch up to her sister, because, like, obviously, this is just her, they're still close now, but they're starting to drift apart, and we see those signs, how Lilith is just like, oh, she's scrambling, trying to catch up to her sister. She wants to make the coven. She wants to get into the coven, the Emperor's coven with her sister. And she leaves, and then frickin' Rain shows up. They're even holding apple blood, which I think is so funny. And it, like, just shows how Ida's like, oh, now I like apple blood. And it was because of Rain. That's how we get to see Ida's, not addiction, but I guess liking toward apple blood. And I just think it's a really nice ending to the episode where, you know, they start to become friends or potentially, you know, blossom into their romance that they have later, which eventually does fall apart, but whatever, it might get back together at the end. But the very ending of the episode, which I really love, is like it ends the flashback, we get a scene of Terra and Rain, and I absolutely love this. I absolutely love this because I felt like before it was even revealed, you could just tell, I'm sure a lot of other people could tell, how Rain is under like this spell or whatever, he's like drinking the tea. But once he whistles, it's like, oh, you know, he countered the spell. Because we saw early in the episode how he, like, whistles to his drinks and changes their properties. You know, he changed the taste of the drink. He changed other things by using bard magic. He uses bard magic to counter Terra's freaking, I don't know, forget mind potion, I'm guessing. I don't know, her brain rot potion. I don't know what to call it. But we see that Rain is still, you know, Rain is still themselves. Terra thinks she has Rain under her control, but no. Rain's doing their own thing. I like how especially, once Terra leaves, freaking Rain is like, it's time. We're going. We're doing this. And they take out, like, a little abomination thing? They, like, knock on the stone or whatever? And a little abomination comes up, and it makes me wonder who made that abomination. Personally, I think it's Darius. As we've seen, Darius is already sort of not entirely a big fan of what Bellos does. We've seen that in the last episode, how he's like, oh, whatever, Hunter, I don't care about taking these freaking kids and making them part of the coven. I was just gonna take him back to Hexside. Like, obviously he just kind of looks like a slacker. Like, he's doing what he has to do to remain a coven head, but maybe he's like, you know, also undercover. It's very interesting. I don't know, but then again, he also, you know, fought against Rain. So, I don't know. I don't know if it is Darius. It's hard to say, but I just really like this ending, how Rain is like, oh, I'll keep you safe, Ida. You don't have to worry about this, because obviously Ida's already been through a lot. You know, owl beast, almost petrified, pretty much a criminal for her entire life. And Rain just wants to, you know, keep her out of danger, which obviously isn't going to happen. You know, Ida and freaking Luce are going to get into danger one way or another. They're the freaking main characters. Like, it's going to happen. It's going to freaking happen. But we're just going to have to see how that happens. I don't know. I'm a big fan of this episode. I really like it. I really like how you get to see more into Ida's backstory and more into Rain's backstory, because Rain is becoming a very important character as of late. It's just like they've been appearing in like almost every episode recently. But yeah, one last thing is taking a look at this draining spell, which I think is cool. So obviously, we see this is the Day of Unity. This surely has to be what is going to be happening on the Day of Unity. We don't even know entirely what the Day of Unity is. Obviously, being called Unity, we see the eclipse. It might be something about how they're going to revive the Titan. Maybe they're going to combine the human world and this world. Maybe they're going to combine all the worlds. We have, you know, channel power through the 9 powerful, which is the coven heads. Drain through sigils, whatever. Sigils as in the glyphs, I'm not sure, or just like, I don't know, something like that. Spell Center is up where Bellus will probably be. Door is being moved. I'm guessing the door is just the door to the human realm, or just the door that allows people to traverse through worlds. I don't know, but the whole point of the main nine covens is to suck the magic out of everybody and push it up towards the eclipse, which is weird. This is also an eclipse where the sun is covering the moon, it looks like, or is it the moon covering the sun? I don't know. I don't actually know. It's one of the two. Boiling Isles, whatever. But something is covering something, probably the moon over the sun, and whatever that means, it's gonna be big. One last little thing to note. We know how King is always calling himself the King of Demons, right? And we know, like, the Titan is a thing, right? Well, when you look, we've seen the Titan before, and it kind of looks similar to King's helmet, right? Obviously, we see King in a promotional image where there's like a whole town full of people like King. Maybe they are ancestors of the Titan. We know that King is important. We've seen the whole, you know, King backstory. The Titan is surely an ancestor of King. Probably. Maybe. I don't know. Nothing is confirmed. But if you look at like this draining spell thing, and you look at the Titan in the background, we see the double horns, we see the nose, and we see like the eyes. If you look at King's freaking helmet skull thing, it's really similar. It's very, very similar. And if you look at like, I don't know, I guess the difference is the Titan kind of has a mouth, so it's not entirely the same, but like maybe evolution is a thing, I don't know. I mean, if you look at King's dad, he's actually a bit different. He kind of looks a bit more like the Titan than King does. Well, I guess he has like pointy, he's like got like rounded thorns. I don't know. It's weird. We don't entirely know. It's just a thing I wanted to like throw out there. There's like just a lot to take in with this draining spell thing. Let me know your thoughts about this episode. I'm very much interested in seeing where this is going to go. Nothing crazy plot happened except for like this very ending of the episode where we know that Rain is now, you know, under their own control. They're not under freaking Terra's control, which is fine. So yeah, that's going to be it for me. I'm very interested in seeing where this goes. And I'll probably talk about this next week because I've started this channel and I just wanted to talk about cartoons. Again, I do want to branch out and talk about others. I've mostly just been talking about, I've just started this channel, basically. I started talking about Amphibia. I'm talking about Owl House. And I'll probably talk about others. Like, I might want to talk about, like, Ed and Eddy, because I love Ed and Eddy. Maybe Ghost and Molly McGee. I started watching that show. It's pretty funny. It's nothing crazy. It's just, you know, compared to Amphibia and the Owl House, at least. It is still in its season one, so maybe there'll be some more plot. But that show's fun. I don't know if I want to super talk about it, because I don't find it as interesting as these two. Maybe, I don't know. For now, I'm gonna be talking about the Owl House and Amphibia until Amphibia ends, and Owl House's season 2 ends, so yeah, that'll be it for a while, and I'm sure I'll branch out. I do want to talk about maybe like a couple animes as well, like I do want to talk about One Piece or something. I don't know. That's stuff for a different video, though. That'll be it for me. Let me know your thoughts. Thanks so much for watching, buddy. I hope you have a great day, and I'll see you all in the next video. Bye-bye.